I'm Richard Gottherer, and I'm co-founder and chief creative officer of a company called The Orchard. I started The Orchard in 1997 with a partner, Scott Cohen, and the idea was, it was a great idea, and it still is. The idea was to take all the independent music, all the music of the world, make it available for everybody in the world, so music, as the shared experience, could penetrate culture to culture and break down barriers between people. Great idea, but you also have to run a business, and you have to run it as a business, and especially in 2003, we took an investment, and if there's any invested people here, you know that they're not interested in spreading culture. They like to do it, but the object is to make money. That's okay, you know? So I wonder, and there's nothing wrong with making money. So as I was preparing to talk, I started thinking, how did I get here, you know? And what were the elements that made it possible for me to even have these thoughts about spreading music? And I'll get into The Orchard a little bit later, but I want to take you back to some of the beginnings of where I started and music, music that influenced me in some way, and things that I did to travel through time and get to the place where I could found The Orchard. Let's see if this works. It doesn't work.
Why do fools fall in love?
Why do birds sing? If you know the song, sing along with it. Oh, there's a way to break of day. Seymour, you know it. Fall in love. He goes falsetto. Well, that's, of course, Frankie Lyman and the Teenagers, Why Do Fools Fall in Love? What you're looking at was my first influence, because my parents were foolish enough to get me a transistor radio. And on that transistor radio, much to their dismay, in the 1950s, the middle 1950s, I would listen to what became known as rock and roll. But what was really interesting about it, and what's significant and touches the culture, especially in America, I was a white Jewish kid from the Bronx, New York. But the music that interested me was music that came from the black culture. This was unheard of in America, and it shows you what music was able to do. If anything implemented the changes in our society in America and taught people to forget about segregation and the differences between us, it was music, because people like me and my partner, who you meet later on, Seymour Stein, we learned about this kind of music that we called rock and roll, but most of the artists we listened to were not white artists. They were black artists. And here's how we heard the artist, was through a disc jockey named Alan Freed.
Hearts made of stone.
I know. I stopped it. I didn't. Okay. I mean, we don't know how long we want to do this, but here's the thing. Later on in the song, the singer goes, and I said, no, 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 no. Everybody knows. I thought you knew. Hearts made of stone. Well, you'd be listening to the show. And now you're talking about your 13-year-old child, and you're listening to Alan, and you're idolizing him in the music, and he'll go, kids, the first caller that calls in and tells me how many times he said no wins something. I don't remember what it was. And it made an impression. Now, how many times, I mean, I could waste time and play the whole song, but how many times did he say no? How many? 13. But I would guess 12, because I forgot about everybody knows. That counted as a no. Yeah, it's really, I mean, these things, these leave the impressions that lead you into great things in later life. Chuck Berry.
Maybelline, why can't you be true? Oh, Maybelline, why can't you be true? You done started doing the things you used to do.
Think so fast.
As I was motivating over the hill, I saw Maybelline in a coupe de ville. A Cadillac rolling on an open road, nothing out of run my V8 Ford. A Cadillac doing about 95, bumper to bumper rolling side to side. Maybelline,
why can't you be true?
Oh, Maybelline, why can't you be true?
Yeah.
You done started out doing the things you used to do.
You done started out doing the things you used to do. I mean, amazing. Chuck, what's great about him was he was a mixture of not just blues and R&B, but in a sense, country music. His lyrics are so well-structured, and the songs are so great that if you don't know about Chuck Berry, he's someone you should learn a little bit about. And in terms of the history of rock and roll, certainly a seminal figure. This next gentleman...
miles of barbed wire. I use a cobra snake for a necktie. I got a brand new house on the roadside made from rattlesnake hide. I got a brand new chimney made on top, made out of a human skull. Now come on, take a little walk with me, Arlene, and tell me, who do you love? Who do you love? Who do you love? Who do you love? Who do you love?
Ah, who do you love? You know, an eternal question, right? It doesn't matter where you live, where you go, who do you love? And also, what can you get out of it? There has to be something in it for everybody, whether it's an important message, health, or just a lot of fun. This is Jerry Lee Lewis. I'll tell you the story after you listen.
Help me, Mr. Fireman, please. You know I'm burning from my head to my knees. I'm a flame with such a burning desire. The little girl sets my soul on fire. She got me burning up like a paper cup. Woo, 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 I'm on fire.
Ah, so that song is called I'm on Fire. The thing that's significant about that is I was 16 years old when I wrote that song. Not that it's a great achievement. it's that at 16, I was a piano player. So there was Jerry Lee Lewis and Elvis Presley. I didn't care about Elvis Presley that much because he didn't play the piano. Jerry Lee played the piano. So I wrote this song, and it's sort of, I wouldn't call it a paraphrasing of Great Balls of Fire, which was one of his great hits, but it was appropriated from the style of that song. I remember, so I'll even sing a little without Jerry Lee. They were going to have a piano, but it's not here, so I'll pretend. Help, Mr. Fireman, please. I'm burning from my head to my knees. That's clever. I'm aflame with such a burning desire. At 16 in America, you had no desire at it, but a burning desire. That little girl sets my soul on fire. She got me burning up. And now here's where I get really clever, and you know there's a future. She got me burning up like a paper cup. Woo-hoo-wee! I'm on fire. Now, that's really, I mean, you know that there's a genius lurking in there somewhere. You know, I mean, so anyway, I wrote that song by myself, and then I continued trying to write songs and would go down to Manhattan, where there was a section, the old Tin Pan Alley. There was a building, one or two buildings, but one particular one called the Brill Building. And that was where there were young songwriters, music publishers, independent record companies, and you could walk throughout the building and meet your contemporaries and place a song with a publisher and perhaps get it released and recorded by an artist. This is the Brill Building.
Tonight you're mine completely. You give your love so sweetly. Tonight the light of love is in your eyes. Ah. But will you love me tomorrow?
Treasure, you know, it's the eternal female wondering if this was just a moment in time or if something deeper is going to happen. Of course, the guy who was there didn't really care at all. I mean, men haven't changed one bit, right? And thank goodness women haven't either. So you can see, I mean, the example of the songwriters, Jerry Lieber and Mike Stola, Carole King, Jerry Goffin, Jeff Barry, Ellie Greenwich, Doc Pomus, what you... These are people that wrote great songs in the mid-60s that were recorded and covered by artists that were looking for great songs. This is before the artist or the band, before the Beatles, if you will, wrote songs themselves. They would look to professional songwriters, and they would look to young songwriters who understood their experience. And the interesting thing about the Brill Building experience is where another event happens in my career I call chance encounters. While I was waiting outside of an office, there were two other guys waiting as well. And we were kept waiting too long, and we talked to each other. What do you do? What do you do? Say, well, we write songs. So we said, well, why don't we go write a song together? And we went, and we wrote a song together, and then we wrote more and more and more. And these people became my partners for a number of years, and we wrote a number of hit records together and grew up and became producers. And this was the first number one record we had. Some of you might know it. I don't expect that it was successful in India, but we'll see.
He went away, and you hung around and bothered me every night. And when I wouldn't go out with you, you said things that weren't very nice.
My boyfriend's back, and you're gonna be in trouble.
Hey, la, hey, la, my boyfriend's
when you see
back.
Him coming, better cut out on the double. Been spreading lies that I was untrue.
Hey, la,
my boyfriend. So look out now, cause he's coming after you.
It would make a really great, if there's anybody here from a film company, it would make a really great placement in one of those Bollywood movies with all the dancing, you know? I mean, the boy could come from the side, run over, and she's like this, you know, doing all those things, and then another bunch of them come in. But, you know, I mean, look at these. These girls could have been in 1960s Bollywood. I mean, It's possible, but unfortunately they weren't. And, you know, but things like that got me here, and that's a good thing. The original recording of I Want Candy. So, tell you about being a sheep herder, okay? So, this happens right after the Beatles and Rolling Stones came to America, and the music business shifted from the songwriter professional to the band writing. So, we did a record prior to this, and in the middle of the record. Because of the, quote, English invasion, which, of course, this country knows about. The English invasion of America, but they were just bands. They just took the money from the people who went to the shows and bought their records. But we put a narration in the middle where we went, oh, little love, that's lovely girls and girls love, not all that comes and goes, that's all I want from you. Sounds completely British, you know. But and we make a recording, and it wasn't this record yet. And a disc jockey calls us up from Virginia Beach, Virginia, and says, "If you guys come down here, I can make this record number one." But we weren't performers. But we said, "Sure, number one. If you could get a number one at anything, take it. That's good advice to anybody who wants to be in any business. Number one, okay." So we said yes. We go down, and we drive up, and we go to the radio station. He says, "What are you doing here? You can't come in. They're waiting for you at the airport. You're supposed to be from Australia." So there we were. We became Australian on the spot. We went to the airport, got on a small prop plane, and they taxied down the runway, pulled up in front of the terminal. It's a small terminal, and there's a sign saying, "Virginia Beach, Virginia, welcomes Australia's strange loves," and there was 100 little girls throwing teddy bears and jelly beans at us. It's really true. It happened. So then we're stuck being Australian. So what do Australians do? They herd sheep. What else would an Australian do? So we became, that's sheep herders. And if you look closely, you might see someone you recognize. That's me. Yeah, that's me. And you, thank you, thank you. And you know, yes, I look very much the same. You're right. You're right. I knew it. But what's really interesting about this is that Americans were so smart, they always knew that these Maasai war drums were actually indigenous Aboriginal Australian drums, and the zebra skins were indigenous to Australia. The zebras were running around Australia. 1960s, mid-60s America, geography, cultures, you know, didn't really fit. But it's okay, and I love America. I have nothing against it. I do, and it was fun growing up there. Well, there I am, so. That song is called "Hang On, Sloopy." It was a number one record in across the world. What's significant about that is that's another important step in my career. Because of that record, I met another fellow music business person who was promoting records at the time. And we became friends because of that. And we eventually went on and became partners. You're going to hear from him later today. His name is Seymour Stein. And we became partners and we started a company together. Sire Records. So that was the first big hit record on Sire. It's by a group called Focused. It's an instrumental. In the middle of the record, somebody goes, yodi, 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 and yodels. And for some reason, that was attractive. And it sold lots and lots of records. And we went on. We formed Sire. And we had some success. This, you can hear a little bit of Psycho Killer by the Talking Heads. This was CBGB's, right about in the fabulous time of the emergence of Blondie, David Johansen, the Ramones. All these people are outside of this fabulous, legendary club. But I'm not going to talk about this because perhaps you can coax it out of Seymour, who carried on. And I left Sire around that time. We remained friends, but not business partners after that. I left Sire, and Seymour carried on with Sire and built it into something really, really special and unique. And I'm sure you all appreciate his accomplishments. Okay.
I saw you standing on the corner. You look so big and fine. I really wanted to go out with you. So when you smiled, I laid my heart on the line.
Debbie Harry, Blondie. Okay, so that was from the first album. I produced the first two albums, and then, of course, they went on and had monstrous success around the world. The interesting thing about that, it's called Ex-Offender, which is a good title, but American Radio and the record company wouldn't release it in 1976, 77 America. It was originally called Sex Offender. Just saying the word sex without implication of anything. So we had to change the title to X. So I came up with that and put an X there. Significant about this, and I'll tell you a really quick story, and then we'll move on to other things. Something very important happened in my life involving Blondie, and it wasn't just that I made money or that it was hits. I was in California doing another record about 7 years, 8 years after this, and I get a call from someone that there's someone I know that has a bunch of your gold records sitting under her desk, and she's got to get them out of the way. So I said, oh, well, okay, I don't mind having the records, and why don't you just, I'm going to have dinner tonight at such and such a place. Why don't you just invite her along and tell her to bring the records? This woman shows up with the records, and we've been together ever since. It's 20 years. Yeah. My wife, Anita, who honestly is the next really big influence in my life. And, you know, it's like we have lots of husbands and wives, but this one's special. But I don't have that many. I don't mean I'm, you know. Okay, now I'll just tell you about this really quickly. The Orchard. I told you I started in 1997. I told you what the motive was. One, it's to be financially successful, of course, because business is business. But it goes beyond it. The Orchard, the real message of The Orchard, if I could really articulate it and make it happen, is really to break down the barriers between people through music. The internet and digital music has made it possible. You used to have to manufacture records, worry about if a record company in France wanted to release your record, whether it was from India or the United States. You faced the same battles. The UK, Germany is. Makes no difference to us. At The Orchard, we release all the music that we represent. I started with one artist, a bass player. If I could find him, I forgot his name now. But I remember he was standing with his bass. He had his shirt off and his hair down to here. And he wanted his record distributed. We took it and put it out. We now distribute over 2 million titles. 2 million. Started in 1997. We started signing digital rights in 1997. iTunes didn't launch in 2000 until 2003. We supply nearly 700 retailers, and we account for 12 to 15% of all the digital music distributed around the world. Come on, let's go. Okay, we're in all these places. And we have general offices in London, Paris, Barcelona, Berlin, and then representatives throughout the rest of the world that aggregate content for us and also are able to deal with the local iTunes and their equivalents in the local language, understanding the local culture, so we can actually market to them. You notice Calcutta actually spelt the proper way because we understand that. That's because one of our main relationships in India is with Saragama, and their offices are there. We distribute Saragama's digital throughout the world, as well as all these other Asian labels, South Asian labels, and I'm sure you know many of them. And you probably know this. Yeah, I know. But, you know, when you try to put a PowerPoint together, you just try to get that good music in there. A.R. Rahman, you know? I know, something's going to burst out in a second. You know, I mean, if they did that with my boyfriend, maybe I should talk to him while I'm here. If he could do that with my boyfriend's back. All right, but you know this. I don't have to keep playing this, right? Unless you like to hear that big punch. It's going to, come on. There it is. Okay. All right. So these are the labels we work with. And as you see, The Orchard being here and me being here in India and taking this music and bringing it to the rest of the world opens up infinite possibilities. We're back to this again. So there's the ride. The transistor radio too.